Hi, everyone. Welcome back to our YouTube channel, Mastering the Wedding Photography Biz.
I'm Hunter.
And I'm Sarah.
And if you're watching this video, it's probably because you are tired of trying to figure out shooting in manual using the exposure triangle, which is probably one of the least helpful and most confusing diagrams ever created by humankind.
Yep. So in today's video, we are going to teach you about how we set our camera's settings during high-end wedding days and portrait sessions without even ever thinking about the exposure triangle. And with a little bit of practice, it is really not as complex as you might think.
So for starters, we are going to ask you to do something that you probably didn't expect we were going to ask you to do today. Take a moment and think back to your middle school math class.
Now, don't worry if you don't think of yourself as being good at math. This actually doesn't have anything to do with math, praise God, but is a really helpful example of understanding why we set our settings the way that we do.
So way back in the day, you probably learned something called the order of operations. Now, basically, this was a rule that said, if you're doing a math problem and there are multiple steps, there is a correct order to do things and a wrong order to do things.
So for example, if you have a math equation that reads 3 + 4 × 5, and you add 3 + 4 first and then multiply that answer by 5, you get 35 as your final answer. But if you multiply 4 by 5 first and then add 3, you get 23, and they can't both be right.
So at some point in time, some mathematicians decided that multiplication comes before addition, but then it comes after parentheses, right? This is PEMDAS, in case that term is still floating around somewhere deep in your memory. And it's because of this, again, order of operations, that even if you add and multiply correctly, if you do it in the wrong order, you can still end up with the wrong final answer.
Yeah. Now, if you don't remember exactly the order for PEMDAS, the order of operations, or you're just bad at math, I think I only remember like some of those letters.
That's fine. Totally fine.
Totally fine.
Not important for photography.
Totally fine. Forget everything we just said. The important takeaway from the whole PEMDAS example is that we think of setting our settings in our cameras as having an order of operations as well. And here's what we mean. If your image is too bright, you really have three options. You can close down your aperture, speed up your shutter speed, or turn down your ISO. Any of those three things will technically make your image darker, but the order that you do them in will determine whether your image turns out looking like okay or looking fantastic.
And why is this idea of a photography order of operations better than the exposure triangle? Well, because we think the exposure triangle is really more about memorization, which we know is hard for a lot of people. And if you forget one thing, the whole diagram can kind of fall apart, especially if you don't learn well from charts and diagrams, which we know not a lot of people do. And it kind of for all of those reasons, it can really just be super overwhelming to look at the exposure triangle for the first time and understand it. But thinking about your settings in terms of the right order is more about asking yourself questions and then just answering them logically. And so if you understand the why behind aperture and shutter speed and ISO, then setting your settings is as simple as just asking yourself a few questions and then logically arriving at the best conclusion without really having to memorize any complicated charts.
Yep. So let's kind of pause right here real quick and just do a bit of a review on aperture, shutter speed, and ISO, the three settings of your camera. And then we are going to teach you about our photography order of operations. And then finally, we are going to circle back to just some real world examples that should make kind of understanding how to set your settings seem a lot easier.
So for starters, if you are totally new to the idea of setting your settings in manual, understanding your aperture, shutter speed, and ISO, aka if this is the very first video you've ever seen from us, then we would actually recommend at least thinking about pausing this video and checking out some of the other videos in this series. We have two entire videos where all we do is just explain what aperture is, how it affects your imagery, and how we use it on wedding days and during portrait sessions. And we have, likewise, two videos for shutter speed, two whole videos for ISO. And so if you don't feel like you have a strong understanding of these three settings individually, if you couldn't tell me exactly what they're for and maybe in what situation you might adjust each of them, you know, by themselves, then go ahead and pause this video, click the link somewhere above my head, which will bring you over to the rest of a YouTube playlist on our channel where we break down all of these things super in depth and just sort of brush up on these one by one.
Yeah, but for the rest of this video, we are just going to assume that you guys have kind of a basic grasp on the three settings. And here's just a very quick recap. And again, if this starts to mean nothing to you, go and check out those videos if you need a more in-depth explanation. So let's start with aperture. A closed down aperture like f/16 is not going to let in very much light, but it will give your images a very wide depth of field, which is great for landscape photos or other images where you want your foreground, your midground, and your background all in focus. On the other hand, a wide open aperture like f2 is going to let in a lot of light and also give you a very shallow depth of field, which is perfect for portraits where you want to isolate your subject and have more of like that blurry kind of dreamy background.
So when it comes to shutter speed, it is all about motion. Now, a very fast shutter speed, like 1/1000th of a second, is going to really perfectly freeze any motion that's happening when you take the picture, but it's not going to let a lot of light into your image sensor. Now, on the other hand, a really slow shutter speed, like 1/15th of a second, is going to let in a lot more light, but any motion that was happening when you clicked your shutter speed is going to end up being blurry.
And finally, ISO. A low ISO, like ISO 100, isn't going to allow your image sensor to pick up much light, meaning that your images will be darker. However, they'll be free of that graininess or noise. And on the other hand of the spectrum, a high ISO, like ISO 6400, is going to pick up a lot more ambient light, which means a dark space will show up brighter in your images, but it is going to produce a lot of graininess or noise in your imagery.
And the most important thing to remember with all of these settings is that they all affect the brightness of your image, but they all have some sort of trade-off, right? So with aperture, it's your depth of field, with shutter speed, it's motion blur, and with ISO, it's graininess. So as you aim for an image that's properly exposed, aka, you know, it isn't too dark or it isn't too bright, you technically can adjust any of these three settings.
Yeah. And why are these trade-offs important? That's because there is no such thing as like a perfect setting for every situation, since each situation is going to depend on the amount of light that's available to you and what it is that you're trying to capture. What is your subject? Mm-hmm. So what separates an amateur photographer from one who understands shooting in manual is the ability to come into a lighting situation and set their settings to get a properly exposed image.
But here's the thing. Technically, there are, you know, basically an infinite number of combinations that will technically yield a properly exposed image. But because of these trade-offs, not every combination of settings that yields, you know, properly exposed imagery is actually what you want in that situation. So in our opinion, what separates someone who just understands shooting in manual and someone who has mastered shooting in manual is not just finding a proper exposure, but finding the right combination of settings that's going to give you proper exposure and the type of imagery that you actually want to produce. And so let's jump in a little bit deeper into what that means.
Now, we told you earlier that we were going to teach you our order of operations that is gonna kind of let you expose the exposure triangle altogether.
Forget the exposure triangle altogether, yeah.
I don't even remember the exposure triangle.
Yeah,
I think you tried to teach it to me once and I was like,
I haven't looked at it in 10 years.
Yeah. So this is the photographer's version of PEMDAS from that math example that we talked about earlier. Here it is. It is aperture, shutter speed, and ISO, abbreviated to ASI.
Now, the reason we shoot using this particular order, the reason we do ASI, is because as high-end wedding and portrait photographers, we feel like one of the biggest differences that separates images taken with a professional camera and a professional lens versus something taken on an iPhone or with like a point-and-shoot camera is that really dreamy, shallow depth of field that professional photography equipment can capture. And so, in general, our first goal is always to keep our aperture basically as low or as wide open as possible while still getting our subject in focus.
Yep. So the first thing that we ask ourselves is, what are we shooting? What is the lowest possible aperture that I can shoot at while still getting my subject in focus? And if you saw our video on aperture, you should know that answer right away. For detail photos, solo portraits, or portraits of a couple that are like close together, that's somewhere, you're gonna want your aperture somewhere around like f1.8 or f2. And if our couple is moving around or like not quite as next to each other, we're gonna aim for closer to like f2.8 or even as high as like f4 to be safe, depending on, again, how they're standing. And if we're shooting more than two people, we'll start at least f2.8 for a very small group. And then our aperture will continue to go up as needed toward like f4 for a medium-sized group or toward like f.8 or f8 or higher for like large groups of people with multiple rows, you know.
But the key here is that we are always keeping our aperture as low as possible because no matter what we're shooting, we want our subjects in focus and everything else should melt into the background, right? This is why we don't just say, oh, let's just keep it at f16 all the time to be safe. Now, these apertures that Sarah just mentioned are good general rules, but like we mentioned in those videos on aperture, when you're first learning to shoot with low apertures, be sure to check your LCD screen and zoom in on people's faces pretty frequently to make sure that they really are in focus. But anyway, now you've set your aperture, you have done the A in ASI.
So once we have set our aperture, we're going to move on to the S in ASI, which is shutter speed. The question that we ask ourselves here is, how fast are our subjects moving? Again, if you saw our videos on shutter speed, you know that there are like a handful of minimum apertures that we use as a starting point, kind of like the ones that we just went over. But if our subject is standing very still or we're shooting a stationary object, we can usually get away with like 1/60th of a second, but no slower.
And that's if you have a steady hand.
Yeah, I do not. So I shoot at like 1/125th because your girl shakes. If our subject is walking or dancing slowly, we want to aim for around like 1/200th of a second. And if our subject is like dancing or like jogging, we don't want to get our shutter speed any lower than 1/500th of a second.
And remember, here with shutter speed, the key is that 99.9% of the time, really our main goal with shutter speed is just to avoid motion blur. So these are, again, general rules, but be sure to be checking your images, reviewing them as you take them to make sure that you aren't accidentally incorporating any motion blur. But now you've set your aperture and your shutter speed, and all that's left is to set your ISO.
And here's what we love about using our ASI order of operations instead of the exposure triangle. At this point, our aperture is set to get like sharp focus on our subjects and a blurry background, and our shutter speed is set to just perfectly freeze whatever motion is happening in that image. And to set your ISO, you just have to turn the dial until your image looks right. And it's that simple.
So it's actually as easy as once you've set your aperture and your shutter speed, if your image is too dark, just turn the ISO until you're up until your image looks bright enough. And if your image is too bright, then turn your ISO down until your image looks dark enough. Mm-hmm. That's it. You have now found the perfect exposure settings for any particular situation that you are in.
Yeah. Now, if you have a mirrorless camera, finding the right exposure this way should really be pretty easy. And after all, as you adjust your settings, the actual exposure of your image will show live on your like LCD screen or through your electronic viewfinder. So finding the right exposure is going to be instant and super simple. You're just going to turn that dial until your subject's faces don't look too dark or too bright.
It's literally as easy as just looking at their faces. Now, if you don't have a mirrorless camera, if you're still using a DSLR, don't stress. Basically, all modern cameras have a built-in light meter. And it's this small sort of line with a bunch of other lines coming off of it that is going to be visible both on your screen. And sometimes even when you look through your optical viewfinder, you can actually still see it maybe down at the bottom. It's going to look something like this.
And this light meter is taking its best guess at what properly exposed should be and is telling you just about how far off you are. So if it looks like this, you're two stops overexposed and should darken your image. Honestly, don't worry too much about what a stop or exposure value is right now. Depending on how your camera is set up, each stop is either 2 or 3 clicks of any of your settings. So in this example, when you set your aperture and your shutter speed, if you're now two stops overexposed, you just need to turn your ISO dial in the direction that brings your ISO lower either 4 or 6 times, depending on whether your camera is set to move in half stops or third stops.
Now, the internal light meter is not perfect, but it will definitely get you into the right ballpark. So once you've landed on that with your camera, and your camera says, you know, according to the light meter, that it is properly exposed, you can take a test shot, review the image on your LCD screen, and then make minor adjustments from there, take another test shot, and hopefully, you know, basically you're ready to start shooting. But back when we used to shoot with DSLR cameras, we got to know our cameras so well that we knew that when our camera landed on one stop overexposed, so when our actual light meter looked like this, we knew that that was probably going to be a perfect test shot, but sometimes we would still make slight adjustments from there. But now that we have mirrorless cameras, we don't really look at our internal light meter all that often because we can actually see live as we update and change our settings. We can see exactly what our final image will look like, whether we're looking through our viewfinder or looking at the screen on the back of our camera.
So, as promised, let's jump into some kind of like real world examples. Let's say that we're shooting a wedding and the guests have like just finished eating dinner. In a moment, the maid of honor is going to stand up and start her speech. We don't want to use flash for aesthetic reasons and just to also keep this example extremely simple. So we're going to follow our order of operations, ASI.
So for starters, we're going to set our aperture. Now, we are only photographing a single person, and we really want to isolate her from the background so whatever's going on behind her isn't distracting from the emotions of her giving her speech. So we're going to keep our aperture nice and open at f1.8.
Yep. Next, we are going to set our shutter speed, and since our subject isn't likely to move and shift around as she's talking, like, or I guess because she is going to shift around while she's talking.
She's not going to be moving that fast.
Yeah, she's not going to, like, sprint off, let's hope. We can set our shutter speed at 1/125th of a second.
And finally, we set our ISO. And so at this point, we are going to either look through our electronic viewfinder on a mirrorless camera, or maybe look at our built-in light meter on a DSLR. And we're going to see either way, probably, that the image is too dark. And so slowly, one click at a time, we're going to bump up our ISO. We're going to go from 500 ISO to 640 to 750 to 1000 to 1250 to 1500. And as we're adjusting the ISO, as you're seeing by these basically example images, we're going to watch our electronic viewfinder or built-in light meter get closer and closer to what we think or what our camera thinks is properly exposed until finally we land on settings and are able to capture images like these.
Now let's do another example. Let's say this time we're gonna start an engagement session and we've just met our couple at a gorgeous spot, we're chatting with them and we're starting to set expectations about what the next 90 minutes is gonna look like. And while we're doing this, we are also setting the settings on our camera, keeping ASI in mind, aperture, shutter, ISO.
So we know that the first thing we're going to do with this couple is sort of ease them into their engagement session with some walking photos. And because there's a bit of variation in any two people's gait, you know, at any given time as they're walking, you know, one of them might be a little bit closer, a little bit further. And so we're going to make sure that our aperture is at least at f2.4. And, you know, maybe if one's way taller than the other, we might even go f2.8.
Next, we set our shutter speed. Our couple is going to be walking, so we set our shutter speed up to like 1/250th of a second to make sure that their movement isn't blurry.
And finally, again, you're probably sensing a theme here, we're going to look at our LCD screen or look at our light meter and see that, you know, in this example, oh, it looks like our image is overexposed. So what we're going to do is just turn our ISO down click by click until the image looks good. And in this case, we landed on ISO 25, which is our very lowest ISO setting. And then we're able to snap images that look like this.
But what happens if it's really bright out and our ISO is at the lowest setting and the image is still too bright? Did we break the ASI order of operation? Well, no. In some cases, you will actually have to bounce back to shutter speed in order to land on your right setting.
So let's look at an example of what this could look like. So for the sake of simplicity, let's just say that we're at another engagement session, but this time it's really bright out. Now, for all the same reasons as above, you know, we're still going to set our aperture at f2.8 because we still, you know, we're going to have them walking, want to make sure they're both in focus, and we're still going to set our shutter speed at 1/250th because we don't want to go any lower than that. And then, you know, we do our adjustment, our ISO gets to 25 and it can't go any lower, but our image is still too bright. You know, it's still looking like this.
In this case, since our ISO can't go any lower, we have two options to make our image darker. We can either speed up our shutter speed or we can close down our aperture. And since keeping our aperture as low as we can go and still capture, you know, our subject in crisp focus with that blurry background, that's going to be our first step and our highest priority. So you're going to want to start working backwards on your ASI order of operations and take a second look at your shutter speed.
And intuitively, if you stop and think about it, hopefully this should make sense. Because while closing down your aperture would technically make the image darker, it would start to lose that shallow depth of field and it would start to look a little bit more like an iPhone snapshot, you know, because almost all, you know, it'd bring more and more of the background and the midground into focus, which is, like we said, basically our highest priority is to not do that. On the other hand, if you speed up your shutter speed in a situation like this, all it's going to do is just freeze even faster motion, but they're walking. So you really won't notice any difference as you speed up your shutter speed from, let's say, 1/250th to 1/1000th, other than the fact that the image is just going to get darker. And in this case, since we need the image darker, that means it's going to be better exposed.
It's a bonus. Now, we know that this was a pretty long video, even for us.
We do love some videos.
Then we know that this is a lot to take in. But if you're still learning to shoot in manual, keep in mind that the absolute very best thing that you can do to get better is to just get out and practice. Mm-hmm. Put yourself in a variety of lighting situations and just practice setting your settings using ASI and see how it turns out.
Photography is a lot like going to the gym and getting stronger muscles. The more you exercise it, the stronger it will get. And eventually things that used to feel really heavy, like setting your settings, are going to be as light as a feather and you can do them without even thinking about it.
Yeah, let's go get swole. But that is it for this week.
Guys, thank you so much for watching. If you want more great content and advice about learning to shoot and run a successful photography business, we would really encourage you to join our Facebook community called Mastering the Wedding Photography Biz with Hunter and Sarah.
In that community, we are building a free community of other photographers who are also building their photography businesses and just helping each other out along the way.
And of course, like, subscribe, and comment below if you have any questions so you'll know when our next video drops next week.
Till next time.
You're doing great. Well, we're going to be showing some images right here until we can cut it. Yeah, so.
This is going to die.
I know, we're almost done. So give it a...
Hey, everyone.